Good morning, everyone. Let's continue with the use of viruses as examples of different topics in evolutionary biology. And I have changed a little bit my mind about the what to tell you today. I was planning to do something, but after talking with Kavita yesterday, I decided to change. So I will start talking about adaptive dynamics. And if I finish with enough time, then I will tell you something about systems biology of virus-host interaction, which is needed for this, is the background for this afternoon talk. So adaptive dynamics in viruses. You have been listening a lot about adaptive dynamics last week, I guess, no? With Daniel Fisher and Joachim Krug, and about fitness landscapes. And adaptive dynamics in viruses, this is a slide similar to the one I showed you the first day. It's basically in viruses, what we have, remember, is a highly polymorphic population, where basically you don't have, you have genotypes that differ in a number of mutations, but the consensus sequence, the average sequence of this basically carries no mutation because each one of the mutations is at low frequency, and there is a dominant sequence, which will be this one. If you do a serial passages experiment, the type of experiment we do, or if you think in a more natural setup, you think in the transmission of the virus from different parts within the infected tissue, from the lungs to the gut, from the gut to the stomach, things like that. The virus is simply moving massive amounts of particles from one to the other. And when these things happen, basically, there is no drift. So natural selection is probably the only important evolutionary force acting on these populations. That means that the virus is going to adapt to whatever situation new is facing. The paradigm of for understanding adaptation, for studying evolution, is the civil rights fitness landscape metaphor. This is a very powerful metaphor that non-theoretically oriented evolutionary biologists really like, because it's very visual, it's very simple to understand. You simply order in one of the axes the alleles for different genes, and the other axis, different alleles for the same gene. So each dot in the surface represents a genetic combination, and the height represents the fitness of the corresponding genotype. So that is really visual to see how many possible adaptive solutions you have in the landscape, and also it's relatively simple to understand how the populations move on the landscape until they reach an adaptive peak. This example here represents a situation where you have a starting population, which is somewhere in the landscape, is not well adapted, and there are two adaptive peaks, one is higher than the other, and simply by chance, simply because mutations have random effects on fitness, imagine that the first mutation that is catched by this population moves it towards this small peak, and it's a large effect mutation, and the population bounces around the peak, fixes more mutations, and at some point gets to the top of the peak where it gets adapted. Simply by chance, but if you reproduce the experiment, you try to do the experiment again, starting from the same original point, given this random nature of mutations, there is a chance that the first mutation pushes the populations toward another peak, and then the situation repeats. The new mutations start fixing until the population reach the top of the peak. You know all this very well. I'm not discovering anything here. I just refreshing your mind on these very simple things. One of the properties of this adaptive walk is the following, and it's represented in this figure. So if you have two realizations of the experiment and you draw the two trajectories in this two-dimensional a plot with fitness versus time, there are two properties that I want to highlight here. The first one is that there is a certain degree of parallelism, Okay, the two trajectories look similar, although they get to final different points because this peak is higher than this, so this goes upper and this is lower. And the second property I want to highlight here is how these curves kind of tend to curve down and reduce the speed of adaptation. I mean, as the speed of adaptation being the slope at any time, so they reduce the speed of adaptation as they get close to the peak. And this is a kind of general thing or a theoretical expectation that the farther you are from the optimum, the more likely you catch mutations of large beneficial effect. But as you get close to the optimum, those mutations necessarily have to be of a small effect. Because, I mean, it's quite intuitive. If you have to reach the peak, you don't want to jump over the peak and fall down the other side. You just want to stay on the peak. So mutation has to be sequentially smaller and smaller in effect. And also because the availability of possible mutations, given the distributions of mutational fitness effects, you expect more small effect mutations than large effect mutations to appear. At the beginning, when you are far away from the peak, a small effect mutation can also be produced, but because there is still chance for large effect mutations, when you have a large effect mutation, it's going to outcompete the small effect mutations. So this is the theory. This has been hanging around for many, many years. Science Sewell presented the theory and the metaphor of the landscapes. But the question is, how much evidence, how much experimental evidence we had to support this idea that adaptation should follow these kind of saturating functions where fitness reaches a top? Necessarily flats off, but kind of decreases in speed. So we are, oh, by the way, this simplistic view of the landscape, as I say, is a view that non-mathematical evolutionary biologists and biologists in general love because it's easy to understand, but the landscape actually is something much more complicated in topography and will be something like that or even more complicated, okay? So it's a really complex mathematical structure that requires advanced mathematics to really understand how the populations can move in the landscape. Anyhow, as I say, the question was at some point, late 80s, early 90s, the question was, okay, how do we have an experiment in which we can really track the fitness of a population as it adapts to an organism and then test all these ideas? In that situation, you see the numbers here, the years of publication of these papers, they are quite old now, is when I started my PhD. And at that time, I was starting my PhD working with viruses. That was one of the questions. Basically, my PhD were two different topics. One was the dynamics of adaptation with RNA viruses. And basically, we did the very simple experiments. We took a virus, vesicular stomatitis virus, the rabies-like one. And we did the very simple experiment of taking the virus, non-adapted, ancestral virus, and we did serial passages, as I described yesterday, in a number of different hosts, okay? So this was host one, host two, number of hosts, and then we did the experiment with different ancestral viruses, ancestral one, ancestral two, three, or so on. The ancestral viruses differ in their fitness, in their original fitness in the host, and the different hosts, as I showed you yesterday, they impose different selective pressures to the virus. In this slide, I'm summarizing a lot of work and a lot of experiments, and basically each panel corresponds to a different genotype of the virus, and they are ranked from the, this is in log scale, so they are ranked from relatively high fitness, MRC, to lower fitness, minus one in log scale, so 0.1, point minus three, point one, and so on, okay? So they have different starting fitness, and basically each line represents a different replicate of the experiment, so we have multiple lines, sometimes just two, three, or four, or more. So the scale here is time in days of passages. So basically, usually 50 days, except here in this experiment that we continue up to 250 days. And basically what you can see is some kind of linear tendency to increase fitness or some saturation as the theory predicts. So this is also, this looks linear, but this has a kind of curvature, but this and this are clearly following the expected pattern of curvature in the fitness trajectories. Yeah, no, the curves are the fit to a hyperbolic curve. It's not any theoretical model what we are fitting. It's just the best fitting to a hyperbolic curve. What else can I tell you from here? So there is some interesting observation is if you look at the upper numbers in the scale, so basically, except this guy that started from a very, very low fitness point and stays on around zero, so the neutrality. These other guys, they all increase fitness basically to a maximum of 2 or 3 in log scale. In this case here, where we have a long, long, long time series, we did a bunch of additional analysis. I'm not going to show you the results of those analyses, but we basically studied the fluctuations in values around the mean. Because it's kind of, if you look in all these other short-term experiments, things remain pretty homogeneous, so they are quite clean, nice trajectories. And this was the case here until a certain time point where then we started having lots of fluctuations. Here indeed, because I'm mixing multiple, 4 different lineages, it is not that, well, I mean, dots have different shapes and things like that, but these fluctuations, when you do a proper analysis, they are not random, I mean, they are not white noise. They are not, the noise, the amplitude of the fluctuations is not fitting to a normal distribution as you expect for noise, but they are fitting to a power law, which to me, I mean, is kind of, well, so what? But for my physics colleagues, it's kind of, oh, this is a self-organized phenomenon, whatever. I'm not going to enter. But basically, yeah, we show in these studies that the expectation is actually what we got. Remember, this is the first of these papers was published in 95, meaning that we started experiments in 91 when I started my PhD. And at that time, Rich Lemsky published the first paper of the long-term evolution series. And that paper for me was like a big discovery, because someone else in the universe was interested in the same type of questions, on the same type of experiments with E. coli, not with viruses. And that was kind of a big discovery for me. So as you see, there is viruses adapt and evolve quickly to anything, but what determines this slowdown? What are the possible explanations to determine this slowdown? One of them is, what you discussed last week with a lot of detail, probably, knowing the speakers, probably was a really, really detailed discussion on the theory and the mathematics, is called the clonal interference. So clonal interference basically is a old idea. It was not really discovered in the 90s, but it's a really old one. And basically, this is a scheme, it's in Spanish. It's a scheme showing you how the size of the population interacts with the fixation of beneficial alleles. So in an asexual population, if you have 3 possible beneficial mutations, A, B, and C, the first one to appear is A. A starts expanding in the population, and then B and C appear in 2 different lineages, and they have to compete each other because there is no sex to bring them together in the same genotype. And this competition means that A gets fixed, B and C get removed from the population, and then B and C, in order to get fixed in the future, they have to appear on over the A background, and then you have this possible situation, A, B, A, C, they compete each other, and the best one is going to be fixed until you finally get the three mutations fixed. So that means that in a large asexual population, the fixation of beneficial mutations is sequential on time. So the best one gets fixed first, then the second best one, the third best one, and so on. The effect of sex, and this is the classical classical argument for the advantage of sex, is that recombination basically brings together beneficial mutations into single genotypes, and that speeds the rate of adaptation. So with sex, the three beneficial mutations have been fixed in this period of time, whereas without sex, you need all this period of time to fix the three mutations. This is for very large populations. What is the situation for small populations? Basically, it doesn't matter, because the population being small means that the population spends most of the time waiting until the next beneficial mutation appears. So it doesn't matter if it's sexual or asexual. You first get a mutation, and then basically you wait until the next mutation appears. And this waiting time usually is quite long, because depends on the rate of mutations and the availability of possible beneficial mutations. So this diagram, this idea of the, this is what is called the clonal interference, okay? Because you have clones carrying different beneficial mutations that compete each other and interfere each other on their way to fixation. If it is only a beneficial mutation possible, it only has to compete with non-beneficial genotypes, and then it's easy to get fixed in the population. But if you have to compete with other beneficial mutations, that excess of competition with guys that are as good as you or at least close to you, that is slowing down the rate of adaptation. I know they are better, I think the first formal analysis of the clonal interference model was the paper by Rich Lenski and Phil Gerrish, published in 98. At that time, I was with Rich as a postdoc. And that is a first formal presentation of the model. There are further developments of the model that consider other properties based on more rigorous mathematical analysis. This model, for instance, is not considering deleterious mutations. It is focusing only on adaptive evolution, so they discard deleterious mutations. But other models proposed later on by Daniel Fisher or Mike Desai, or Igor Rausin, they incorporate deleterious mutations and they incorporate other factors, and they make a much better description of the processes. However, for my presentation today, it is enough with what Phil Gerrish and Rich Lenski show. Okay, so they make a series of predictions, and we tested those predictions with the virus. So the first prediction they made is that the probability of fixation of a given beneficial mutation decreases both with population size and mutation rate. Why is this? Because the product of population size and mutation rate is giving you the availability of possible mutations. It's the effective number of mutations, of competing mutations that you have. So the more possible mutations competing, remember, they only care about beneficial mutations. The more beneficial mutations coexisting in a given time point and competing, the more intense will be the clonal interference, and then the probability of fixing one of them, of these mutations, is decreased, because there are other competing ones that might be better and then outcompete it. And as population size and mutation rate increases, adaptive substitution results in a larger fitness increase. This is a kind of consequence of the first postulate. So that means that if you have a series of competing beneficial mutations, and there is one that is the best possible mutation in that context, that best possible mutation is going to outcompete each other and is going to be the first to get fixed. Okay? So this is shown in this figure, and this is an essential, it's too light. Well, it doesn't matter. Here, basically, you have the log of population size. Here you have the expected selection coefficient to be fixed. And here what you have is this function, this exponential-like, although it's not truly exponential, function where as you increase the number of possible beneficial mutations, the probability of the effect of the mutation that gets fixed increases and gets maximum. Okay? So this is the prediction of the model, and these are the results of the experiment. I have to tell you how we did this experiment. They are really simple, as usual experiments. So what we did was we mixed two genotypes of the virus. Let's call the MARM C and wild type. These two genotypes of the virus are genetically identical. They are exactly identical, except one amino acid replacement in the glycoprotein C, in the glycoprotein G, that makes this guy resistant to an antibody. Okay? So they are identical, except this is resistant to a monoclonal antibody, I1, and this is sensitive to the monoclonal antibody, which means that if we play them out in presence of the antibody, these guys are not growing, and these guys are growing. Why I say that? Because we did the experiment in the following way. We mixed one-to-one the two guys, the MARC and the wild type. Okay, we mixed them, we infected cells, and then we started doing serial passages. And at each passage, we quantify the ratio. Okay, by plating them out in presence and absence of the antibody. So this, the original ratio was 1-to-1, after one passage was 1-to-1, after two passages it was 1-to-1, and so on. And at some point, the ratio changes to 1-to-10, 1-to-100, and so on. And then we isolated the virus from this. I mean, in this case was wild type, because it's the one increasing in fitness, in frequency, and then isolated the virus and measured this. Okay, so S according to that figure. So what is the, do you understand the logic of the experiment? It's basically you mix them together and they keep the same frequency. That means that they are not fixing beneficial mutations. As soon as one of the two of them fix a beneficial mutation, it starts increasing in frequency, and it's what we detect here. Then we take this guy and measure his fitness by a competition assay. And this is what is shown here. Here is what we are showing. I mean, and we repeat it many, many, many times at different effective population sizes. And this is the average of a bunch of lineages repeating this experiment at each one of the population sizes. So this is what we got. This was the expectation. So this, remember, this was the expectation, the shape of what we was expected, and this is what we got. No, this is fitness. Fitness of the first mutation fix. Because in larger population, you have more competing beneficial mutations, and then the best one is going to be fixed. In a small population, you have less beneficial mutations, so less beneficial, in magnitude, will fix. That's the main tenant of the Gerrish-Lenski theory. Okay? So, from this data, Phil Gerrish fit, in this case, is, the line, the solid line is the fit of Phil's model to the data. And what he was able of inferring from that fitting is the beneficial mutation rate, which is really low compared with the total mutation rate of the virus, and the average fitness effect of the beneficial mutations, which is quite high, so a 30% beneficial effect. So actually a big number. So what about more predictions of the model? The third prediction of the model is that the rate of adaptation is an increasing but decelerating function of both mutation rate and population size. It's basically what we have been discussing. If you fix, you have more and more beneficial mutations coexisting in large populations, that means they spend more time competing and they interfere each other in the way to fixation. So that means that the rate of fixation has to be is slower than expected if there is only one beneficial mutation present. So in other words, if you have a mutation for which you know the selection coefficient, you will predict a rate of fixation. If you start adding competitors with which are also beneficial, that rate of fixation is declined. So that's the second prediction, which in mathematical, I mean, plotting the equations that field develop, this is what you expect. You have in log-log, in a log-log plot, what you have is something like that. It's something that grows fast for very small population sizes and then flats off as population sizes really get large. So to test this hypothesis, what we did was repeating this experiment here. We basically measured the fitness of this population, this population, this population, and so on, okay? For different population sizes. And this is the result. The result here is presented as as linear log, so it has a different shape. I never change the figure. Basically, I'm fitting to the data two models, a linear model implying no clonal interference, so the more mutations you have, the more faster you evolve, and it fits the data, and the solid line, which is a hyperbolic model, which implies that there is a limit to the rate of adaptation. So there is a declining function of the number of possible beneficial mutations. So the fit of the hyperbolic model is significantly better as it can be tested using the proper statistics. So the data also support the predictions of the Field-Gerrish and Lynch-Rich-Lenski model of the clonal interference, as the rate of adaptation is also a decreasing function of the number of possible competing beneficial mutations. More recently, we have tested the same on the plant virus system. We basically took different inoculum size, different initial population, different effective population sizes, which are here, one-tenth of the norm of the standard and 10 times the standard, and then we measured the rate of adaptation. This is rate of adaptation on two different hosts, the natural host and a new one, and there are two fitness traits. Things are not completely consistent across traits because, for instance, looking at the rate of adaptation in viral load, in the number of viral particles produced, you have this decreasing function, obviously, here. This is somehow weird in the new host, and here in both, for both hosts, you have this decelerating function of the rate of adaptation, in this case for infectivity, which is the efficiency of the virus infecting the plants. So even with this other more complex system, in this case, remember, it's not in the vesicular stomatitis case, it was a very simple experimental setup with cell cultures and passages, serial passages, Arian de Visser did these experiments with Rich-Lenski, the equivalent experiments to prove the clonal interference with E. coli. They did with the long-term lines, E. coli on LV, which is, again, is a very simplified system. And here is a much more complex system because it involves plants, and real infections and a lot of other things. But basically, the idea is that even in those more complex situations, the flat off in the rate of adaptation is kind of evident as you increase the number of possible beneficial mutations coexisting. So another of the predictions, of the interesting predictions that the model, the simple model by Phil and Rich made, is that beneficial mutations might become transiently common, but do not get to fixation due to the interference with other ones, And these mutations should be quite common. And these transient polymorphisms might give rise to what they call the leapfrog effect, which basically means that the genotype that is finally fixed in the population is not necessarily related with the most abundant genotype a number of generations before, but with a genotype that was a much lower fitness in the population. Okay? So this is basically what they call the leapfrog effect. We didn't make any specific experiment to test for the leapfrog effect, but we have done experiments, other sort of experiments, with the plant virus in this case, in which we basically track the dynamic using Illumina sequencing. You all know what is Illumina sequencing? No? It's a sequencing methodology that basically gives you a huge coverage, a huge amount of molecules sequenced out of the sample. Okay? So you can, depending on the precise chemistry that you use and depending on the length of what you want to amplify, you can get coverages up to 100 or to 20,000 times the same nucleotide is being sequenced in the population. Okay? So using that technology, you can detect things that are at a frequency of 1 over 20,000. Depending, as I say, on what you want to sequence. But using that technology, we were tracking the dynamics of infection in single plants of tobacco and pepper, the normal and the new host. So we were tracking how the population diversifies on the plant, and then we took the entire population, transferred to another plant, and repeat the process of sequencing. So we were sequencing, we were characterizing both what happened within a plant and what was the effect of transmission and then expansion. When we did that, basically, this is our, we have 2 replicates in tobacco and 2 replicates in pepper. And basically, each one of these colors is a, corresponds with a haplotype. Okay? So the, in black is the original ancestral haplotype. And here in tobacco, what you see is how new haplotypes appear in the population. Some of them appear and then disappear. And some other, for instance, this purple one appear. And on the background of the purple one, the pink one appears, and on the background of the pink one appears the green, the blue, and so on. And here, for instance, what you have is, or here, so you see that there's some transient polymorphisms that appear, disappear, and then some other new ones appear and disappear. And here, for instance, you have this mutation that is spread out in the population, the pink one, and other mutations that were appearing, but not from the pink background, but from the remaining ancestral, and they reach some frequency, but they disappear. And then what we have here is another mutation which basically appear over the pink background and spreads from the population. So we have kind of some examples. I mean, I'm not saying that this is a massive support to the leapfrog, but some of these cases are well explained by the leapfrog effect because are mutations that are, or some of these, for example, that are not appearing on the most numerically abundant one, but in other backgrounds rise to some frequency. And in this case, they were outcompeted, but in some other cases may not. So some conclusion from these clonal interference experiments. Adaptive substitutions appear as discrete events, but they do not occur as the result of single mutational events, but instead they represent the best possible candidate given all the competitors that you have at a given time point. Because the rate of adaptation is not positively affected by increasing mutation availability, this is a message for some virologists. It is questionable whether the high mutation rate of the viruses is adaptive by itself or instead is a byproduct of the way the viruses replicate, and decreasing the mutation rate will not really affect the adaptability of the virus. There is some lot of legends among virologists that the high mutation rate is adaptive, but per se. It's like ignoring that most of the mutations produced are actually deleterious. Consequently, high mutation rates are the result of a trade-off between, well, whatever, keeping the genome compact and maintaining the system for detecting errors and corrections. And basically, that's all. So that's all I have to say about adaptive dynamics in large populations. Before I move ahead, any question? The best possible candidate at a given time point. What I mean. It's a combination of being lucky and being good. I mean, obviously, if you are the third one on the list, but you were so lucky that you appeared 100 generations before the best one, you got fixed before the best one appears. Of course, there is a combination of being lucky in the sense of being the first to appear and your choice. Yeah, I mean the best of the possible coexisting candidates in a given time, in a given moment. It's not the absolute best, if you want. Because, by the way, all these models ignore epistasis. So once you get fixed the first one, the entire value of the other ones changes now. It depends on the presence of the first mutation. More questions? Doubts? Would you either use the microphone or I just walk over next to you? Thanks.
Yeah, why did you use the other strain in this experiment, the resistant strain? What was the rationale behind that?
We're using two strains here? Mm-hmm. Yeah, because if I only use one strain and I get a mutation fixed, the way I detect that a mutation, beneficial mutation has been fixed is because it results in a displacement in the ratio between the two genetic markers. Mm-hmm. If I only have one strain and a beneficial mutation increase, I cannot detect it. Oh. I mean, remember, this was done in the 90s, the late 90s. So Illumina was not a technology then. So right now, you can simply do with Illumina. You can do Illumina of your population at every passage, and then you will see the frequency of mutations increasing in the population. You can do that with Illumina. But at that time, we didn't have that technology. So we have to be a little bit imaginative. And then the idea was, OK, if I have two genetic markers that I can easily distinguish, and the beneficial mutation appears in one of them, I will detect that mutation because the ratio of the markers will change. That's why we use two markers. No more questions? So let's move on a step forward to the opposite processes. So far, I have been talking during the last 40 minutes about beneficial mutations fixing in the population, in large populations. But what happened in small populations when we are at the other side of the spectrum of population size? Imagine that we have a really homogeneous population, right here, and the consensus sequence, the average sequence, is in red down here. This is not a viral population, obviously. It's no mutations. But here is a viral population. So we have genetic variants. Each one has a mutation. Each one has a mutation. On average, here they have two mutations per genome. But the total consensus sequence has no mutations either, because the frequency of each one of these is low, so they are not reflected in the consensus sequence. But imagine that we do a strong bottleneck. At the most strong possible bottleneck, we randomly sample from this population a single genotype. This is represented by this black arrow. We take this sequence, and we use that sequence to reproduce the viral population. The consequence of that bottleneck is that these two mutations now are going to be fixed in the population. So all the guys have the red triangle, and all the guys except one revertant have this, the blue square. Plus, again, two more mutations on average. One or two or three, maybe, mutations on average. So the consensus sequence now has changed to this one, basically the ancestral one. If we repeat the process and we randomly take one of these these genotypes and allow them to reproduce, the process continues, so more mutations get fixed, and now the consensus sequence also increases in the number of mutations. Doing this type of experiments is extremely simple. This is called the mutation accumulation experiments. These experiments have been done with Drosophila, with C. elegans, with yeast, with bacteria, with viruses, with all kinds of things. I'm probably losing a lot of them in this list. The beauty with bacteria and viruses is that you can do in a much simpler way these mutation accumulation experiments. This is a diagram that I made for a review article for bacteria, and some of you guys here are doing these experiments with bacteria. I don't know where you are now. Yeah, there. So basically, the idea is that you take a plate, agar plate, you spread out the bacteria, and just you go and pick a random colony, and then use that colony, spread out in another plate, wait 24 hours, pick another colony, and just you go by colony, colony, by colony, by colony. Colonies in bacteria, they grow from one cell up to 10 to the 6 or something like that. But they go through bottlenecks of size 1 at every generation. In the case of viruses, you can make the bottlenecks even stronger because you plate the virus out on a monolayer of cells in a plate. You cover it with agar to avoid the virus to diffuse. And then using the microscope, you find a single infected cell or a group of a few infected cells. And using the tip of a pipette, you simply suck the cell or the group of cells with the virus. So in this case, the bottleneck goes from 1 maybe to 3,000 or 4,000. No more than that. Okay, the bottleneck size is much stronger. So the idea is that you can keep that regime going with time, and at each of the passages, basically you expect, and this is an expectation, the number of lineages with as a function of the number of mutations they have, and at the beginning most of the lineages have zero mutations, but as you go in the process, the average number of mutations in the lineages increases, and you might get something like that, no? An average of 3 or 4 with a wider variance. In the absence of sex, this process is irreversible, this process cannot be stopped, and this process is called the Mueller ratchet. The Mueller ratchet means that at every generation, the ratchet clicks one step, and increases the average, loses the less mutated class, and increases the average in one more mutation, or the average number of mutations. And then the mutational load of the population increases in a non-reversible manner. If you keep doing the Mueller ratchet forever, then you enter in a regime which is called the mutational meltdown. Which the mutational meltdown basically is now a demographic process. If you are increasing so much the number of mutations, the genotypes are so sick that they are not able of reproducing and maintaining the population size. So in the case of E. coli, instead of going from 1 to 10 to the 6, they will start going from 1 to 10 to the 4, 1 to 10 to the 3. The colonies will look very sick. They don't maintain the population size, so there is a stochastic problem. Now you enter in a stochastic regime where basically you can extinct the population because in one of the passages you are picking up something which is completely crap and is not able to even reproduce in itself. So that's the mutational meltdown. So that's the theory. In 91, Lin Chao tested the theory using the bacteriophage 5-6, and he showed that actually when you do serial passages of bacteriophage 5-6 from single colony to single colony to single colony, fitness declines, and eventually some of the lineages got extinct. Less than expected, but some of them got extinct. This was the second part of my PhD, and basically what we did here was to repeat Lynch Chow's experiment, but using vesicular stomatitis. And as I say, plating out the virus in solid agar, and then picking up under the microscope groups, or small groups of infected cells, recovering the virus and transmitting again using the serial bottleneck passages. And here you have a figure that shows you the declining fitness for two different genotypes, the high fitness one, MARX, and the low fitness one, MARC, and each line represents a lineage of mutation accumulation. This figure, let me tell you, is misleading, especially for what is interesting you guys. This is not, we did 20 passages, and we measured the fitness at the beginning and after 20 passages. These lines are just connecting the beginning and the end, okay? They are not trajectories, which is what you guys are interested. It's just, they are linear because they are connecting the initial and the final point. But what you see here, there is a distribution of effects. So that means that there are lots of mutations fixed that are basically neutral and mutations that are fixed of increasing the deleterious fitness effect. I mean, again, because there are 20 passages in between, these lineages carry more than one mutation, probably. They carry many mutations. But on average, they are all deleterious. Okay? This is basically, this is only the frequency distribution of, for this. And what you see is that for this high fitness mutant, all of the mutations are mostly deleterious with a mean value about minus 0.4 selection coefficient. For this neutral guy, all the mutations are also deleted, but with an average of minus 0.2 or something like that. So on average, for a high fitness mutant, the mutations are more deleterious, so they lose more fitness than this guy that was already lower in the fitness landscape. So if you are in a high peak, you have more to lose than you are in a low peak. It's basically the conclusion of this comparison. You can apply Mukai-Bettman's method or the maximum likelihood method by Peter Keitley to infer the rate of fitness decline out of this data. And basically, the rate of fitness decline is the deleterious mutation rate times the expected deleterious selection coefficient. And for this guy, is minus 1% per day, whereas for this guy, is lower, is 0.8% per day. You can do some more statistics on this data, and you can start fitting alternative fitness functions or PDF, probability density functions, to the data to infer the underlying shape of the distribution of the deleterious fitness effects. And basically, for the MARX, it's a gamma plus uniform, so it's a kind of a heavy tail distribution. It fits really well, and then the data allows you to separate the contribution of the deleterious mutation rate and expected selection coefficient. So the deleterious mutation rate will be 3 per genome per generation with this selection coefficient. And for the other guy, for the other mutant, the best fitting, which is in both cases is the solid line, is the gamma plus uniform also with other parameters. All other lines here are alternative functions like the log normal or the exponential, things like that. Okay? So that was for the deleterious mutations. And that was, again, that was in the old times before we were able of even doing single site directed mutagenesis. That was mutation accumulation type of experiments. Years later, we decided to repeat the same experiment in the plant viruses. Sometimes I don't get better ideas, so I simply repeat what I have done before. But it's fun. To do this kind of experiment with the plant virus, the problem is that we don't have a cell culture system. Well, we have cell culture systems, the BY2 cells. But they are not easy to handle. They are nasty. And so, but we were so lucky that there is a plant called Chenopodium quinoa. This is a leaf of Chenopodium quinoa. Chenopodium quinoa has a nice property. It is what is called is a necrotic local host, which means that when you inoculate anything, a virus, a bacteria, I don't know about fungi, but virus and bacteria for sure, in a leaf of Chenopodium quinoa, the plant has a very strong response to infection that involves apoptosis. So in any, when a cell gets the parasite inside, the virus in this case, the cell dies itself and then sends a lot of necrotic signals to the neighboring cells that kill themselves. So that's isolating the pathogen from the healthy leaf. Okay, so these are the necrotic spots that you can see in the leaf. These yellow spots that you see, okay, in the leaf, they correspond to single cells infected with a single viral particle. So it's like the bottleneck. No, we can use this as a proxy to the bottlenecks in bacteria on plates, or to the bottlenecks in cell cultures for vesicular stomatitis. So basically, what you do is you inoculate the leaf, then you isolate you choose a well isolated necrotic lesion like this or like that. You take it out of the plant, of the leaf, homogenize, recover the virus, and use this virus to inoculate another leaf. And then keep that going on with time. And when you do this many times with many lineages, and these are what you were looking for, the clicking of the ratchet, this is what you get. So this is fitness, and this is the bottleneck transfer, and you see everything goes down, and they do in a kind of, I mean, some lineages got extinct, like this one, or this one, or this one, they never continue, but some others just keep going until we decided to stop the experiment. But we get a number of lineages extinct. I mean, it's messy, the figure is messy, but there is some cases where you have flat periods and then decline, and then you see flat again. So it's like in one passage, they don't fix anything, and at the next passage, they fix a really deleterious one, and so on. But in some cases, for instance, this one here or this one here, you even get a recovery in fitness. It's like they fix something that is beneficial, but then they keep losing. So on average, everything goes down in fitness. So that's the extension of the same type of experiments to the plant virus. Okay? I mean, you can check the reference for the details. And again, you can estimate out of this using the Peter Keitley's maximum likelihood methods, the rate of fitness decline, which is in this case 12% per passage. Okay, this is not per day, it's per passage. Here passages are 3 days, is the time that you need to develop the necrotic lesions. So it's per passage. And I'm going to stop here. This is a completely different topic. So I'm going to stop here because I want to give you quick overview of the systems biology thing. Any questions about this Mueller ratchet / mutation accumulation fitness decline experiments? is what we call one infectious unit. It's one infectious unit. It's all you need to infect a cell. One infectious unit is not necessarily a single genome, because the particles are sticky and they attach each other, but it's what we call an infectious unit. It might be between one and maybe 100, but no more. And not all of them are, because viral particles, they are, lots of them are really crappy. They are pieces of RNA encapsulated. They are not even entire viruses. So, yeah. So it's, we talk about infectious units. Any other question? Okay, so let me move to a completely different topic, which is a quick introduction, half an hour introduction to systems biology of host-virus interaction. So this is perhaps a little bit a way of the, or not strictly related with the population genetics part of this course, but it's clearly related with the evolution part of this course. It's evolutionary systems biology. Before we get into the details, what is systems biology? As a colleague told me in a granting panel, where we joined to discuss about who gets money from the ministry to keep doing science and who is simply removed from the system because they are useless people. Systems biology is a new invention of molecular biology just to get more money. That's systems biology, basically. So systems biology is what ecologists have been doing forever. It's when you have more than one thing and you study more than one thing at the same time. It's an holistic view of science rather than the reductionist view of molecular biology. Molecular biology has been a powerful thing to understand how the system works, but how very simple system works. Everybody, I mean, when I was doing my PhD, the people spent entire PhD characterizing the function of a single gene and how it was translated in a protein and how that protein folded. To what level that information helped to understand how the cell works? I don't know. I mean, you really know how works this gene in a test tube, but that's all. So systems biology tries to understand the behavior of a really complex system, which is the cell, and how the cell interacts with factors, in this case pathogens, in response to infection, and how the pathogens, in this case the virus, modifies the reactions of the cell in its own benefit to produce what we called the other day the virus cell, and produce the replication and accumulation of things. Systems biology now with the RNA-seq data, with the high-throughput protein-protein interaction systems, with the metabolomic approaches, you can do whatever technique you want or is available at that moment for you, and you can really do massive screenings of things. These two figures are just two examples of the type of results or the type of data with which we work now on the systems biology of host-virus interaction. In the left panel, what you have is HIV. I took this from the internet, and basically you have the different viral genes here in red, the capsid protein, the GP120, the GP11, the GP60, the integrase, in fin, the different viral proteins, and in blue, cell proteins that have been detected as to physically interact with the viral proteins using whatever technique they want to use, and the links, the edges in yellow means interactions. So what you see here is a really, really complex network of interactions between viral proteins and host proteins, and at the end, the outcome of infection is the result of all these interactions. These interactions are really dynamic in time and space. They are dynamic in time within a single cell, because the viral proteins, they do not appear all at the same time. They appear with a certain rhythm, a certain time, and then they establish interactions, and as the things evolve, the network is also changing, and they change in space because different cell types do have different physiological stages, and then the interaction between the virus and the cell is obviously also different. The future of this type of analysis is going to be the single-cell genomics. I have no doubt that in the coming years we will start seeing lots of papers doing single-cell genomics and comparing all these networks between cells. But for now, the best we can do is averaging cells. Okay? This, as I say, this was HIV, and this is our virus, tobacco edge, just focusing in two viral proteins, the VPG and the NEA-PRO, and all these are... The ones in red are direct interactors with the viral proteins. The red arrows mean direct interactions with the viral protein, experimentally quantified using the Yeast2 hybrid system. And the other, the blue and green interactions are two steps away interactors. So interactors that are not directly being touched physically by the virus protein, but they are interacting with proteins that do interact with the virus. So it's a way of showing you how the perturbation made by the virus spreads across the entire interactome, because they are second-order interactions, third-order interactions, and so on. So usually, I will call, along this half an hour, I will call this... genes that are, or these proteins from the host that are directly interacting with the virus proteins, I will call VRGs, so virus-regulated genes, so genes of the cell that are somehow regulated by the virus, either because they are directly being touched physically in contact with viral proteins, or because the presence of a viral protein alters the expression of a given gene. Maybe because it's altering a transcription factor, and then the transcription factor affects whatever is downstream on the regulatory pathway. We started all these studies a number of years ago using a kind of meta-analysis of what was already present in the literature. This was back in 2005, 2006. The number of studies in the literature at that time were very few, and they were mostly used, I'm going to focus on plants, obviously, and was before the RNA-seq, so basically all the data I'm going to show you today are based on DNA chips, okay? If you know what are DNA chips, no? Basically are a class... Glass pieces where a machine has a spot DNA or RNA depends, a primer, like an oligo, corresponding to each one of the genes of the cell. Okay, so you have something like, in this case, the arrays we use, the chips we use, they have 24,000 spots. Okay, 24,000 oligos that match to RNA from the cell. So basically, well, the type of experiment is simple. You get the microarray, you get a total RNA extraction from the plant, you hybridize on the microchip, and then wash, and then there are some chemistry that when you have a matching between your proof in the glass and an RNA, there is a fluorescent dye that gives you a signal. So, and the intensity of the signal corresponds, is proportional to the amount of binding. Doesn't matter. Chemistry. So the experiment we did, or the meta-analysis we did, was based on already published studies in which people took different viruses from different families, and all of them infected Arabidopsis thaliana. People has used viruses from the same family, like tobacco edge, this is our own work, turning mosaic, and plant pox. These three viruses belong to the same botanic family. They are basically the same virus with different names. And then these other viruses, tobacco mosaic, turnip crinkle, tobacco rattle, and cauliflower leaf curly virus. These belong to different families. All these guys, these three plus these three are RNA viruses. This is a DNA virus. Basically, as I said, the experiments all have the same style. All of them infected the plant, and then they collected total RNA of infected plants and of healthy plants as controls, and then they hybridized the microarrays. This is the aspect of a hybridized microarray. And basically, out of here, you can do a lot of analysis, first looking for genes that are differentially expressed according to whether the plant is infected or not. From this data, you can infer what is called gene ontologies or functional categories. So different genes at the end are doing basically the same, so or they are affecting the same biological processes. So from here to there, you go from genes, individual genes, to functions. And in parallel, what we did was to take from the GEO database, we took every available array at the time from Arabidopsis, and using some learning algorithms, we infer a regulatory network out of this data. So this regulatory network basically represents each gene in Arabidopsis and how they are connected according to their expression level. So when two genes are expressing at the same time or suppressed at the same time, they are connected in the network. Okay? So at the end, what we use is this model of network to map on the network the different genes that we observe as VGRs, as genes altered by viruses. So this is what basically we can do on this context of systems biology, identifying every gene that responds to infection, classify them according to their functions, and then mapping them on the networks of regulatory processes. So basically, I'm going to be quick on this. I don't want to waste too much time. Here are the different viruses, and here are the number of genes that were altered, either up-regulated or down-regulated for the different viruses. There is big numbers, I mean, thousands of genes in some cases, and in some cases hundreds of genes, and that's usually the general pattern. So you get big numbers of genes that are altered. If you translate those genes in functional categories, yeah, because you see hundreds of functional categories or tens of functional categories. That's highly variable and depends on the particular virus. There are things that we, this is not the right context to be discussing. But for instance, you can look for commonalities. What is in common between different viruses? So even they are so different viruses. For instance, genes that are related to overexpressed genes are always genes related to response to infection, or genes like this one. And this is irrelevant of the gene. Everything in pink here is means that all viruses do the same. So response to infection, like the systemic acquired resistance, is a plant regulatory system that detects infection and transmits signals to the entire plant to prepare the plant for the arrival of the pathogen. Response to stresses, a bunch of stresses, salinity, cold, heat, but this is kind of well known in plant physiology. All the stress responses in plants are really well integrated. So it's not surprising that if you have a biotic stress, the pathogen, then you also trigger something which is not biotic stress, but other things. Or over among the underexpressed genes, you have photosynthesis. Usually infected plants, they get yellow. So that means that the photosystems are going perturbed. So everything that has to be with photosynthesis and everything that has to be with secondary metabolism also gets down, because the plant, basically the virus, is using all the resources of the plant, and the plant is stopping to produce things that are not essential for the virus. So this is common for every virus in pink. Common for the potiviruses in the list are here in green. So the potiviruses, because they look similar, they do more, they share more properties. Okay? Yeah, if you want to get details, just go to this. I'm going to jump over this and just spend a few minutes on this slide. So the question is, are the patterns, the similarities that we observe in response, can be explained simply because the viruses are related taxonomically? In other words, two viruses that are more similar, phylogenetically speaking, will produce a similar response, whereas a virus that is far away will produce a completely different response. Okay, so to answer that question, which in principle seems reasonable to ask, we build this phylogenetic tree based on the RDRP, the RNA-dependent RNA polymerase of the viruses. This guy is a DNA virus. It doesn't have an RNA-dependent RNA polymerase, so it has been placed like an outlier on the tree, because it's completely independent. But these other guys, all of them share an RDRP. This is a maximum likelihood like tree. And then what we did, we took, so this is a bit statistically tricky. So we took the list of altered genes for each one of the virus, okay? And then you can compare list in a pairwise manner, you can compare the list of genes, okay? So you take the list for, for TUMB and the list for PPB. Okay, you have two lists of genes. Okay, you have UMB, for instance, and PPB. And then you have gene 1, gene 2, gene 3, gene 4. And this guy also has gene 1, but it doesn't have gene 2, has gene 3, doesn't have gene 4. This guy has gene 5, this guy doesn't have. Gene 6, half, and so on, okay? So this guy is altering these genes, this guy is altering these other genes. So basically you can count how many genes are in common in both, okay? And then you can simply calculate a similarity index as the number of common genes twice divided the number of genes in this column plus the number of genes in this column. So this is a similarity measure between the two vectors of altered genes. And then you can construct a similarity matrix and use the similarity matrix to construct a neighbor joining tree. So this neighbor joining tree represents the similarity in the pattern of genes. And then you can use a congruency test to test whether the topology of this tree and the topology of this tree are identical or similar or not. And when you do that for comparing genes with this tree, they are congruent. So it's what you expect. Two viruses that are really closely related, they alter the same genes, whereas two viruses that are less related, they alter different genes. But what happens if we go one step farther and we do the same analysis, but instead of based on genes, we do it based on functional categories? Remember, different genes contribute to the same functional category. So when you do this thing with functional categories, then the two trees are not congruent anymore. Why is that? Because basically they all alter the same functional categories, but they do using different genes. Okay? When you look at genes, they use similar viruses use similar genes, different viruses use different genes, but when you look at functional categories, basically all of them manipulate the same functional categories, but with different genes. At the end, what the virus wants is to stop the plant growing, for instance. And they can do by killing, genes involved in cell wall synthesis or genes involved in development of meristems, I don't know, whatever. But they can do in different manners. Actually, what they do. So finally, that's going to be almost the end. Remember, the last step or the last type of study or the next step of study we did was to construct this regulatory network of the Arabidopsis. It's just one regulatory network. It's a statistical invention. That it might not even have a real biological meaning. It's just a statistical inference. And it's a snapshot of the real regulatory network because this is a dynamic thing that is all going to change with time. And this is kind of an average across time of the real one. It has some nice properties. It's a small scale-free network and a small world, which means that has the properties of certain nice properties of biological and technological networks. These physicists love these kind of things. So, but you have here the network. The network obviously is modular. You have modules that are more highly connected among them than others, like development, metabolism, stress response. So different networks of genes that are related according to their function. So here is the question. Here is a kind of a thought experiment that I want you to do with me. If we have the network and we calculate the degree distribution of a network is a basic property of the network, is how many nodes are connected with one element, two elements, three elements, and so on. So that's the degree. So here you have degree 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and the probability of that degree. Okay? How many actually have 0, 1, 2, 3, 4? If you calculate the degree distribution for the network itself, is this red line here. It's a power law. It's a scale-free network, so it's a power law. This is log-log. So this is a power law here. Okay? The red line. This is a property of the network. Now, the question is, what would be the expected degree distribution if the virus is preferentially attaching peripheral, poorly connected nodes in the network? So if you build a network with the nodes that are altered by the virus, what will be the distribution, the degree distribution? Okay, so if they preferentially attach poorly connected nodes, then you expect the probability of zero to be much greater and the probability of higher numbers being much slower. So you expect a steeper relationship. Okay? You follow me on that? In the opposite, here we have the opposite situation. The virus is preferentially attaching highly connected elements in the network. So the virus is preferentially attaching hub genes, highly connected things. So what you expect, the red line is again the network itself. Now when you construct the network for the sub or the subnetwork for high, for altered genes, what you have is more genes highly connected and less genes poorly connected. So what you expect is a flatter and relationship than the red line. Okay. This is a kind of expectation. Okay. Yeah. How often we find, sorry, what? Unannotated genes. These are the Arabidopsis, it's quite well annotated, but yeah, there are things that are not annotated. There are some bunch of things that are not annotated. So this is our kind of hypothesis. Where is going to be the virus? It's going to be here, like attaching to poorly connected things. It's going to be here, attaching to highly connected things. Or it's going to be kind of attaching at random. If you attach at random, basically the blue and the red lines will overlap completely. When you do the analysis, this is what you get. Here you have the different viruses on different panels. In blue is always the same, is the network itself. And in red are the subnetworks of altered genes. And in all cases, you see that the lines are flatter. The red lines are flatter than the blue lines. In every case, with no exception, the red lines are flatter than the blue lines, which corresponds with this situation. So we can infer with this from this simple analysis that the viruses preferentially, all of them attach or manipulate the expression of hub genes, highly connected elements in the network. So transcription factors, things that are very central in the regulation of the plant life. So one of the things, this is a parenthesis you want, for you guys with a physics background will be kind of trivial, but maybe for biologists it's more new. So scale-free networks, like these ones, they are very robust to random perturbations. Okay? It's like, what is a scale-free network? The airway system, all the airports, they're connected. This is a scale-free network. The telephone company, internet, is a scale-free network. They are very robust to perturbation in random nodes. So if, for whatever reason, there is a big storm in, I don't know, in Western USA, and then Seattle airport closes, that's not going to have a huge impact on the entire network. In internet, if Google systems drop in whatever they are, the internet will not suffer too much because there are backups and redundancy everywhere. So there are other ways to move the signals. So internet is very scale-free networks are very robust to random perturbations, but they are very sensitive to the attack, to the preferential attack to hubs. Okay? When computer viruses spread and they preferentially go to Google, Yahoo, and all the servers, or the searching servers, then the entire internet collapses. When in the US you get a blizzard in a blizzard storm in the eastern and central part of the country, and then you close as New York, Boston, Dallas, and Kansas, and Chicago, then the entire world is affected by that. Or, okay? So it's like, yeah. So the same is here. If the virus attaches randomly to the network, then it will have very little effect, very little impact on the entire metabolism of the plant. But if the virus is preferentially attaching the hub genes, that is spreading very fast on the network, and that's having a big impact on the metabolism of the plant. So basically, that's why the cells at the end die, because they are basically affecting everything. And this is a figure where we analyzed in silico how the signal, how the perturbation spread, in after how many steps the entire network was already affected. And it turns out that after 6-7 steps, the entire network is basically affected in the expression. Actually, this 6-7 in network theory is a kind of magical number. It's the 6 degrees away. I don't know if you have heard ever about the 6 degrees away in scale-free networks. So this is the thing. Any one of you can send a letter to anyone in the world, even without knowing, and it will go through 6 persons before reaching that one. You can do the experiment. Someone did the experiment, and it's true. I mean, you can send a letter in someone in, I don't know, San Diego, California. You don't know anyone in San Diego, California, probably, but you can send a letter to me because you know me, and I have lots of friends in San Diego, so I will send to someone in San Diego, and this guy likely will know somebody in the neighborhood of the other, and then the letter will reach the destinatory after 6 steps. And interestingly, here we have 6-7 steps, everything in the network is altered. The problem with this analysis, with all these studies, there is a substantial, there is a fundamental problem that I just wait until the end to tell you, is that all these viruses, okay, in nature, all the viruses included in this study, how many of them infect Arabidopsis in nature? For how many of them Arabidopsis is a real host? I'll tell you. Only this one. Tourney mosaic. Tourney mosaic infects Arabidopsis in nature. You can find it in central Spain, infecting Arabidopsis, wild Arabidopsis. Whereas the other guys, cauliflower, leaf curly, turnip crinkle, forget about this guy for now, these guys, they do not infect Arabidopsis in nature. At least they have never been described, but they infect plants from the same family than Arabidopsis. Cabbage and turnips are brassica, like Arabidopsis. So at least they don't infect Arabidopsis, but they infect some plants that are related to Arabidopsis. These other guys down here, plant pox is a plant infected, I know, tobacco ash, tobacco mosaic, and tobacco rattle, they do not infect Arabidopsis in nature, or nothing related with Arabidopsis. So when you start comparing the statistics of these guys versus these guys, you see that there are big differences. So the number of altered genes here is much larger than here. The number of interactions in the transcription and regulatory network is much larger here than here. The number of interactions in the average connectivity is much higher here than here, and so on, so forth, also for the protein-protein interaction network, which I didn't mention. So it seems like we can separate the things according to whether they really infect Arabidopsis or not. And this is starting making me worry whether all these things, to which extent all this study was just an artifact of putting a virus which is not an Arabidopsis virus in Arabidopsis. What is the sense of taking a virus which is not Arabidopsis virus and pretend to learn anything when you put it on a completely new host? And this, to solve this thing, is what I'm going to tell you this afternoon, how we solve that thing. For now, that's all.